MS drugs are complicated. In switching from one drug to the other, sometimes you have to wash out the first drug before starting the second. Sometimes you don't want to do that. And in this video, I'm going to explain when and how. Don't turn away, because it starts right now. Howdy you. Thanks for learning about MS with me, Aaron Boster. I started this YouTube channel to help my own MS clinic patients learn between visits. And it's my hope that through my videos, I can help you learn too. Today's topic is drug washouts. What do you need to do to transition from drug A to drug B? Do you need to wash out the first drug or not? Let's jump in. We don't marry our drugs. We take them as long as they're working. And if they don't work or they're no longer tolerable, we may need to change or escalate our therapy. That's not always straightforward. And in this video, I really want to break down for you what's involved in transitioning from drug A to drug B, with a special attention to if you need a washout. Now, what's a washout? That's where you completely remove drug A out of your body prior to starting drug B. Transitioning between drugs requires a lot of thought. There are many, many factors we have to consider. The mechanism of action of drug A and the mechanism of action of drug B. What is the offset of drug A? In other words, how long does it take to clear your body? And what is the onset of drug B? In other words, how long does it take before it starts working? If you stop drug A, is there a risk of rebound disease activity? And if you start drug B, what is the risk of breakthrough disease activity? Also, logistics are very important. Getting through the proper testing for the new drug, setting up an infusion, or getting used to injecting. These are all factors that we have to consider when transitioning between drugs. This video is really focused on the washout period and when and if you need to wash out a given drug. So why consider washouts at all? We're really trying to create a balancing act. If we stack two drugs on top of one another, so you're on drug A and you just add drug B, we might increase the risk of suppressing the immune response and therefore increase the risk of cancer or infections. If we separate the two drugs significantly, where you're completely off of drug A for a period of time before starting drug B, we leave you unprotected. And the aberrant immune response can cause disease activity with attacks and new spots on MRI and disability. The sweet spot would be a hypothetical situation where we don't stack immunosuppression and we don't create a gap where you're at risk of having an attack. And that's what we're trying to accomplish when we consider a washout in the transition between drugs. And one last quick disclaimer. The information in all of my videos, and this video is no exception, is intended for educational purposes only. I want to give you information to help you think through the things and bring concepts and discussion points to your clinic appointments. But my videos are not giving you medical advice, and what I say never ever trumps what your doctor says. You and your doctor have to figure out the right move for you at that time. This video is simply an opportunity to educate. Please keep that in mind. We'll begin by discussing the injections. These are interferon beta products to include using trade names, Avonex, Plegridy, Rebif, Betaseron, and Xtavia, as well as Copaxone. These injections are relatively safe products. And in my opinion, there is zero reason to wash them out. I do not recommend washouts for these products. I quite literally continue these injections up until the day we start our new therapy. Now, in reality, there's actually an argument to be made to overlap. Because there's really no risk of stacked immunosuppression with these products, you could quite literally keep them on as you start your next drug for a couple months. That overlap, theoretically, would help provide further efficacy and protection, while the new drug that you've added takes a while to get started in your body. We now turn our attention to pills. And the first pill I'd like to discuss is Tecfidera, or dimethylfumarate. Now really, when coming off Tecfidera, there's two situations. There's the normal situation, and then there's the situation where Tecfidera's side effect profile has pushed down part of your white blood cells, and you have a low absolute lymphocyte count. And those are two different situations that are treated differently. So let's start with the normal situation. You're taking Tecfidera and you have a normal white blood cell count. Transitioning off Tec doesn't involve a lot of hoopla, and I do not wash out that drug. I simply stop the Tec and start the next therapy. because the mechanism of action of Tecfidera is not immunosuppressant. However, in about 20% of patients, they have a side effect when they take Tecfidera that it pushes down their white count. And it can take a while after stopping Tecfidera before that white count comes back to normal. The fear here is that with a suppressed white count, we have inadvertently immunosuppressed the human at least a little bit. And in those situations, one might need to wash out the Tecfidera to allow the white blood cells to return to normal prior to starting the next therapy. Now, the way that we typically do this is we would stop Tecfidera and start checking a white count with the differential. And that'll give us all the information we need to track their white blood cell count. And we may do this every 2 to 4 weeks. When we see that we're starting to rise, that's when we apply the next therapy. The next pill to discuss is Aubagio, or teriflunomide. Now, Aubagio's mechanism of action is to essentially freeze the white blood cell. It's called cytostatic because it doesn't kill the cells, it just freezes them so they can't rapidly reproduce. And when you stop Aubagio, it can take 18 to 24 months for it to leave your body completely. That's quite some time. And so I really, again, think there are two situations. There's the situation where we need to have Aubagio out of the system as fast as possible. And this would be an example of an unexpected pregnancy. A woman with MS taking Aubagio discovers she's pregnant, and we don't want to have Aubagio on board, so we need to get it out quickly. And then there's the normal situation where there's nothing like a pregnancy that's concerning, and we can treat things very differently. So when you need to get the drug out of your body quickly, there's actually a rapid elimination protocol. By taking one of two drugs, the first one is activated charcoal, which sounds like exactly what it is, it's charcoal, and you drink it. It's kind of disgusting, but you drink it 3 times a day for 11 days, and that will clear the Aubagio out of your system like that. There's also a drug called Mucomist, which is also not terribly pleasant, and you take that 3 times a day for 11 days, and it rapidly clears the Aubagio out of your system. So if there is a need to very quickly transition, and you have to get the drug out of you, there's a rapid elimination process to do that. Most commonly, we're going to leave Aubagio and start a new therapy, and I simply start the new therapy. And yes, Aubagio is going to remain in the system for 1.5 to 2 years, and that's okay, because we're not in a situation where we're concerned about the stacked immunosuppression. The next pill to discuss is arguably the most tricky, and that's Gilenya, or fingolimod. Now, Gilenya works in a really cool manner. It sequesters or locks away 80% of your lymphocytes in secondary lymphoid organs, meaning the spleen or the lymph nodes. And when you stop Gilenya, they slowly release those cells back out into the bloodstream. And that can take 2 to 3 months. Most of the immunosuppressant drugs that we use, they get in the bloodstream no problem, but they can't fully access the lymph nodes, which means if you had someone on Gilenya and the next day you started them on a new drug, that new drug might not be fully effective if the goal of the new drug is to kill cells, because that new drug can't reach the cells. And so you have to go through a washout period with Gilenya. But it gets more complicated because there are rare cases where when people stop Gilenya, they have a rebound of their MS disease activity. So what do? It takes a careful hand. And here's how we typically proceed. Step one is to stop the Gilenya. Step two is to check a white blood cell count with differential about once a month. And when we see that the absolute lymphocyte count, the ALC, starts to go up, we know it's safe because the cells are starting to come back out and we can start the next drug. However, if that takes longer than a month, what we do at our center is we give people a slug of steroids. We'll give them 1 day of high-dose steroids monthly during the transition period. And it's our belief that by giving someone a slug of steroids once a month during the transition, during the washout, we protect them and keep them safe from attack. I can share with you anecdotally that this seems to work really well at our center, but I'm not aware of clinical trials data supporting its use. So take it for what it's worth. When transitioning off of Gilenya, we are truly balancing the concern of stacking immunosuppression against the risk of rebound disease activity. We stop the medication. We have a period of a couple months where we might be off drug. We're following the white count to know when it's okay to start up again. And we're giving a slug of steroid once a month to quell the overly active immune system during the transition. The next pill to discuss is one of the newest drugs on the market, Mayzent. The real name is siponimod. And Mayzent is a Gilenya Me Too drug. It's the same class as Gilenya, but they've tweaked the drug and so that it has a different pharmacokinetics and dynamics. And what's kind of interesting about Mayzent as compared to Gilenya is it'll leave the body quicker. And so we don't have the same theoretical problems when stopping Mayzent. If you stop it, theoretically, in under a week, you're going to mostly get it out of your system. And so the transition off of Mayzent onto the next drug should be a bit more complicated. The next drug to discuss is the pill Mavenclad, or cladribine. And this is another really tricky one. This is induction therapy. As you're aware, you take a pill a day for 5 days, wait a month, take a pill a day for 5 more days, wait a year, and then you repeat on year 2. But if you read the American label, the FDA said something remarkable. They said after the 2 courses, you may not redose for 2 more years, so that would be year 3 and 4. The reason they state is because of concerns of stacking immunosuppression if you give further courses of Mavenclad. Think about that. This creates a problem if someone has breakthrough disease. Imagine a scenario where someone starts Mavenclad, cladribine, and then a year or 2 or 3 years into it, they have an attack, and we feel that we're obligated to escalate. Well, we can't give more Mavenclad. And one of my major concerns, a concern that I have not yet discovered the answer to, is it safe to consider a different immunosuppressant? If I wanted to start a Lemtrada or an Ocrevus, or even a Gilenya or a Tysabri, am I placing that person at risk of stacked immunosuppression? Right now, I don't know the answer, and I'm trying to figure it out. We now transition from the pills to the infusions. And the first drug I'll talk about is natalizumab, or Tysabri. We learned the hard way that washouts for Tysabri are a bad idea. Many years back, there was a thought that if you're going to come off Tysabri, you want to completely wash it out of the body before transitioning to the next drug. And what we learned is that we invite disease activity to come back if we wait too long. Waiting 3 months after stopping Tysabri and not doing something else afterwards is really a recipe for risk. And there are cases, and I've seen cases in my clinic, where someone stops the drug, doesn't start something new, and has a wicked rebound with a devastating multifocal attack and an MRI that lights up like a Christmas tree. I tell you guys, it's scary stuff. We now know better. It is a really bad idea to stop Tysabri and wait 3 months before doing something new. Don't do that. So let's talk about in 2019 how we do this. My strong preference is to stop Tysabri and a month later start whatever I'm going to start. So if I'm making a transition from Tysabri, say, to Ocrevus, or from Tysabri, say, to Lemtrada, I do not want to wash out. I want to immediately transition. And in fact, there's mechanistic reasons why that's a good idea. Tysabri mechanistically pushes all of the white blood cells into the bloodstream because it creates the Great Wall of China for the blood-brain barrier. So you now have all the white blood cells, including the naughty cells, in the bloodstream. When you start another therapy, like an Ocrevus or like a Lemtrada, you're trying to kill cells. And the kill rate in the bloodstream is 100%. And so in some ways, the 1-2 punch of Tysabri to Ocra or Tysabri to Lemtrada is awesome sauce. And I really like doing that. No washout whatsoever. No washout. But there are situations where we can't start the next drug right away, either for logistic reasons or insurance reasons, or for some reason there's a delay. To avoid the rebound, my strong opinion is that each month that you're not giving Tysabri and not starting the new drug, the better part of valor is to give a slug of steroids. So let's say hypothetically that you stop Tysabri January 1st and you're not going to start your next therapy until March. February 1st, I'm giving you a slug of high-dose steroids to tide things over until we can get there. Now, I will make a caveat. Whenever I leave any drug, but particularly with Tysabri, I think it's the best practice to check an MRI prior to initiating the next therapy. I look at that MRI carefully to make sure that I don't see any radiographic evidence to suggest PML. And that makes me much more comfortable and confident as I enter into the next therapy. The next infusion we'll discuss is ocrelizumab, or Ocrevus. Ocrevus is an infusion with a half-life of 27 days. And what that means in English is when you take Ocrevus, it's going to be biologically active in your body for about 4.5 months. And that's important information when you try to make a transition. And I'm going to use the most common example in my practice, which is Ocrevus to Limtrada. Ocrevus kills adult B cells. Limtrada kills adult B cells and T cells. So if you're on Ocrevus and then you start Limtrada, you can't kill B cells twice. So I don't feel that mechanistically I'm stacking immunosuppression. The last drug to discuss is Limtrada, or alemtuzumab. Now, Limtrada completely leaves the human's body in 1 month after being infused, so there's no more Limtrada in the body. But the biologic effects of Limtrada, pushing down the B and T cells, can last a year or more. We remember that the way that Limtrada is given is 5 days, wait a year, 3 days, and then we don't redose unless there's new disease activity. So if we have to transition off of Limtrada, the timing is really everything. If you have disease activity between round one and round two, I just give you steroids. We're not going to transition. After the second dose, if there's new disease activity, then we have a discussion about whether we want a third course of Limtrada a year later or if we're going to make the transition to something else. The point in time that happens is when you're going to have to sort out if you need to wait or not. And I make that decision based on looking at the white blood cell count, how suppressed the counts are, and how bad the disease activity is. I would love to hear from you guys what your experience is with switching from drug A to drug B, and if you participated in a washout or not. And if you did participate in a washout, was it a good experience or a bad experience? So I look forward to reading your comments down in the section below. If you'd like to learn more about how MS drugs work, check out this playlist right there. YouTube thinks that you would adore this video right there. And if you haven't yet subscribed to my channel, please consider doing so by clicking the circle right next to my head. My name is Aaron Boster, and thank you for learning about MS with me. Until my next video or my next live stream, take care.